Welcome back to the show. A senior rabbi in Melbourne has revealed a disturbing anti-Semitic incident that occurred as he walked to synagogue with his 8-year-old son.
Rabbi Daniel Raybin says they were confronted by a car full of people before the group made violent anti-Semitic threats towards him and his young boy. He joins us now. Rabbi, thanks so much for your time this morning. I heard you yesterday on 3AW. It's just horrible what you experienced. Can you talk us through what happened to you and your son?
Of course. Good morning, Sarah. Good morning, Carl. Thank you for having me on your show this morning, bright and early. So look, it was the end of our festival of Sukkot, the final day called Simchat Torah. And we were walking. It was about 6 p.m. in the afternoon. My 8-year-old son, a lovely young guy. And as we were walking, this car drove by. The windows came down and they said vile comments, which obviously I didn't want to repeat, on TV. But they said swear words, Jewish pigs die. And then they sort of smiled and drove off. And of course, as you can imagine, having your son with you, an 8-year-old, just enjoying his walk to the synagogue. Of course, I was feeling already tense, knowing what had happened in Israel just the day before. And it was so confronting to be able to sort of calm him down. And he said to me, Daddy, why do they say such a thing to us? What did we do wrong? And I explained to him, unfortunately, look, there is evil in this world and there are some bad people, but we've got to continue being good people. And obviously the last few days I've been talking to him and he's been grappling with all of this. And who knows how children really process these things.
That's an incredibly difficult thing and conversation to have with an 8-year-old boy. And I know that the Jewish community is really feeling it at the moment. There are conversations going on everywhere. Do you feel like that you are being protected enough and that the heat is being brought out of this in some way by government, or are you still particularly nervous?
Look, the reality is, as a rabbi of a community, a large community, I'm hearing from people all day, every day, lots of phone calls, lots of people messaging, wanting to talk. There's definitely an anxiety in the air. People are concerned. Seeing the rally in New South Wales was just so distressing, to be honest. Here in Australia, a place which I was happy to call home when I came here in 2009, we've lived and enjoyed the beautiful country that we have. And so to see people saying such vile things, reminded me of Nazi Germany, seeing those things as a child, watching, documentaries. And so, yes, there's a real concern. But at the same time, I'm very fortunate to hear from Victoria Police all the time. They're really concerned. They're putting extra resources into, protecting the community, making us feel safe. And so I think, yes, whilst there is, cause for concern, at the same time, there's also cause to be positive, to be proud of who we are, to not stop what we like to do, to enjoy to do here in Melbourne and, of course, across Australia. So it's a fine line to give people the strength and the confidence to continue being who they are, to be proud to be Jewish, but at the same time, of course, to remain vigilant.
It's difficult, isn't it, Rabbi, when you see those confronting scenes in Sydney, a bit of a contrast to the more peaceful process that we saw in Melbourne. But for you and the Jewish community now, I guess the question remains about just how much you have to improve your safety. I mean, we're hearing about people too scared to wear, their Jewish outfits and such to sort of profess their religion. I mean, that shouldn't be happening in Australia.
Most certainly it shouldn't be happening, and I think we've got to call it out. The truth is, and it's important to stress, and I want to stress to your listeners, majority of our country, fortunately, and as I said, I've got to enjoy being in Australia since 2009, and people are incredible, people are kind, people are generous, people support each other. I cannot tell you how many messages I've received in the positive sense from people of all walks of life. A lot of my non-Jewish friends have sent, immediately, how are you doing? Are you okay? Are your family in Israel okay? But at the same time, we've got to make sure that we don't allow any of this type of hate speech and inciting violence to become prolific in our country. We want to be a harmonious place. We want to be able to all enjoy the benefits of this country and to keep it a place, Australia is known to be such a warm and welcoming place, and we've got to stop this right now. And so speaking out, and that's why I agreed to come on the show to say we want to spread messages of acts of goodness and kindness, and that's who we are intrinsically. I mean, in my synagogue every week, that's what I talk about. I stand up on the pulpit, on my podium, and I encourage people to be nice to each other, to do good things, to spread our values of kindness and goodness to the world around us.
Very good, Rabbi. It's a message that we hope gets through, and yeah, it's going to be a long haul, this one. So appreciate that message of peace. Thank you. Well, close to 10,000 people have come together for a vigil in Sydney's East, showing their support for Israel and mourning those lost in the brutal mass attacks. Let's bring in Australia's former ambassador to Israel, Dave Sharma. Dave, good morning to you.
Good morning, Carl.
It was a somber night last night, wasn't it?
It was. It was very moving. A lot of people there have been very, very deeply affected personally, intimately, left a big trauma on their lives. But it was nice to have people come together, and I know they took comfort from each other's presence.
It's a big thing, having comfort in spite of what has happened, or along with what has happened, because it has been so brutal. There's still a lot of fear, isn't there?
Still a lot of fear. I mean, there's, you know, bodies are still being identified and located in Israel. There's still somewhere around 100, perhaps north of 100 hostages being held by Hamas in Gaza. And people are worried about what's going to come. Is there going to be another conflict to open up? Is Hezbollah going to invade from the north? Any number of things.
I'll get onto that in just a second, because you know it so well. But some shocking incidents of anti-Semitism have surfaced this week, including this video of a man threatening four teenagers after they tried to put an Israeli flag in the back of their car.
Put it back in your car.
This occurred in the Sydney suburb of Bellevue Hill, in your former electorate. The behaviour is just so shocking, and the concern is that there'll be a repeat of that in the coming days and weeks.
Absolutely, it's shocking. I mean, these were young boys, one of whose fathers I know, wanting to put an Israeli flag in the back of their car the day after we've seen these awful scenes emerge from Israel, just to express some solidarity with the state of Israel. And here you have someone in their home neighbourhood making threats to take their lives if they do this. I mean, this is unacceptable in Australia.
Joe Biden kind of warned that this war may escalate in parts of the world that we haven't seen yet, essentially putting us all on a warning level. How concerned are you, and do you think that the moves from the various state governments yesterday will appease some of that?
I'm very concerned. I mean, if you saw what happened when Islamic State went on the rampage in Iraq and Syria, there were people in the Western world, including in Australia, who were inspired by and sought to replicate some of the things that they were doing. We were on a heightened terrorist threat here in Australia throughout that period. And I think we need to be taking the same sort of steps to upgrade our security now.
You'd know what it's like on the ground in Israel better than most, having been ambassador. If we're in for a ground war, whenever it comes, it looks inevitable, doesn't it?
It does.
And what will that look like? And how long a period are we looking at being involved with?
I think it's going to look pretty awful. I mean, Israel has not gone in on the ground in Gaza in any strength since 2014. And they're going to have to go in a lot further than they did in 2014. Gaza is densely populated. There's a lot of civilian infrastructure. Hamas is embedded in hospitals and schools and things like that. It's going to get awful. And I hope, I mean, a way needs to be found to try and protect the civilians in Gaza.
You're talking about 2 million people, 40 kilometres by 11 kilometres.
Exactly.
It's a small area. I don't know where all those people go. And that will be weighing into the decisions that the Israeli forces have to make, along with the hostages at the moment.
Absolutely. I mean, could look like Stalingrad. It could be that bad. But there is a border crossing with Egypt. Egypt does have a border crossing open with Gaza. And I know talks are underway with Egypt. And it's important we play a role here to encourage them to open a humanitarian corridor.
What more can we be doing here?
Well, I think we certainly need to be taking threats to our own domestic security seriously. But we also need to be, political leaders need to be condemning and making absolutely clear that some of the protest action we've seen in Australia is completely beyond the pale and unacceptable. We can't allow that sort of behaviour, like you just shown on television, to be normalised. But beyond that, we should be talking, of course, to Israel, but also the partners in the region to see what we can do to help stabilise the situation.
Are you alluding to some of our senior politicians and the way that they have approached this from the start? John Howard said it in his own unique way yesterday. He said we were pussyfooting around, words to that effect. We need to get real clarity here before it escalates further, right?
Absolutely.
So we have guidelines.
I think our political leaders were too slow out of the blocks on this, and they've been found wanting, and I think they've taken important steps to correct that now, and I think that's important and valid, but things should never have been allowed to get to this point, is what I'm saying. We could always see this is going to be a big issue.
Finally, does it add to the angst, the nervousness, the anxiousness inside the Jewish community?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, people in the Jewish community are worried about sending their children to school. They're worried about going to synagogues. They're worried about going out and doing their shopping because they're seeing these horrific images in Israel being applauded by their fellow Australians. And, of course, that's going to be distressing.
Dave Sharma, good to talk to you.
Thanks so much, Carl.
Sarah.
Thank you, Carl. Well, more than 1,000 police officers will be deployed to an unauthorised pro-Palestinian rally in Sydney this weekend, following the wild scenes that unfolded at the Sydney Opera House earlier this week. Let's bring in Nasser Mashni from the president of the Australian Palestinian Advocacy Network in Melbourne now. Thanks so much for your time this morning, Nasser. Now, we saw two very different scenes at protests this week. Peaceful in Melbourne, disgraceful, unacceptable in Sydney. I guess it stands to reason then that the New South Wales police would take this tough stance.
I'm going to refute the fact that the protests were different. They were both the same protest. The reality of protest movements and people coming together to express concerns about situations is that at times people, some unwanted people will come along and provoke, do some unnecessary and unwanted actions. And, you know, violence is never going to be an answer, as is anti-Semitism is never going to be an answer. In 2014, and the ambassador for Israel was just speaking about that ground invasion, 51 days in Israel. At Seredot, the residents of that village put chairs on a mountaintop and watched, like a cinema, the bombing of Gaza. In every people, there are some people that are going to do some things that aren't correct. And I just want to address that.
You can't condone those images that we saw in Sydney and what people were saying there as well.
Sarah, I'm not condoning those images. As to the veracity of what was on those tapes, I've been advised by another senior journalist that nobody's been able to verify the veracity of that audio. Now, let's be clear. Palestinians, we're Australian. The most important thing is for us all to come together. We're all in pain. As human beings, we are sharing the pain and suffering, not only of the deaths of Israelis, we should also be feeling the pain of Palestinians. I've barely slept in 2 days, Sarah. I've got a friend whose grandmother has been told to leave Gaza, and she said, I was ethnically cleansed from Deir Yassin in 1948 as a two-year-old. I don't want to leave Gaza. I'd rather die here than die in diaspora. The situation in Gaza is 16 years of air, sea and land blockade. This is the sixth war on 2.5 million captive people in an area
we know
365
that these have been
square
horrific.
Kilometres.
It's been awful for everyone who lives in that region. I mean, you've got ordinary Israelis, ordinary Palestinians who are caught up in this. But at the end of the day, we do want to see more of those peaceful types of protests that we saw in Melbourne, that you were at, not what we saw in Sydney. And I guess the question is then, how do you weed out those who are going to cause trouble if you do plan further protests in the future? I mean, it undermines your cause.
Sarah, what we need to be doing is de-escalating the language. At the moment, throughout the West, we've got a situation where we are manufacturing consent for a genocide. There's an Israeli minister who said he wants to unleash a Jericho. Now, a Jericho is Israeli language for a nuclear bomb on Gaza. The finance minister said Palestinians have got three choices. They can live as second-class residents with no rights, no voting rights. They can leave or they can die. We've got the prime minister of the State of Israel saying he's going to turn Gaza into a deserted island.
Yeah,
And we've got President Biden saying all the way with LBJ.
When we hear things like gas to Jews here in Australia, I mean, that is unacceptable.
As I said, sorry,
you're questioning whether or not that's true. But we're also hearing stories about Jewish community members in Sydney and in Melbourne, probably in other parts of the country, who are being targeted for their religion and being told that that people want to kill them. I mean,
it's absolutely unacceptable, Sarah. It's absolutely unacceptable. That's five times I've now said it, Sarah. What's also unacceptable is the police telling Jewish Australians they can't attend the Opera House based on some Islamophobic construct that supporters of Palestine are Muslim. Jesus, the most famous Palestinian, was a Christian. The babies that are getting pulled out of the rubble in Gaza today, they look like the baby Jesus. We are Australians too. Somebody needs to speak up and say our humanity matters. Sarah, have you asked me if there's any Palestinians in Gaza? No one's asked me if there's a Palestinian. There's no efforts to try and evacuate any Palestinians in Gaza. There's no seaport, no airport, no train station, no egress to the rest of the world. You've got children. Children in Palestine, in Gaza, have got no hope, no education. They've not been to a rock concert. They don't have educational opportunities.
Our kids matter too, Sarah. I don't think anyone disputes the heartache that those communities are experiencing. And we know that the US, among others, are trying to evacuate those 2 million civilians out of Gaza safely into Egypt. And I guess now,
Sarah,
what we're talking about here in Australia is what message you have to Palestinians here, to Israelis here, about coming together and uniting.
Firstly, Sarah, Egypt endeavoured to deliver some aid to Gaza. Israel bombed the Rafah crossing, number one. Number two, my message to all Australians, irrespective of whether they're Muslim, Christian, Jew, secular, agnostic, whatever the religion might be, is that we're all human beings. We have a shared humanity. Tomorrow needs to look like the dream my father used to have, and that was the dream that he had when he grew up in Jerusalem in the 20s and 30s, and that it didn't matter the colour of your skin or your religion. All that mattered was what sort of human you were. That has to be something we're working towards tomorrow. And if our foreign minister calling for restraint is something seen as a bad word, what's wrong with our country? We need to be calling for restraint, asking for an immediate ceasefire. We need to apply international law. Increasingly, the world has determined that Israel is an apartheid regime. We need to dismantle that and apply international law, Sarah.
Yeah, I think the point you made there about us all being humans is the most valid, and that's something we should all remember. All right, Carlos.
We're in the thick of this for a while.